Hey, church family, Pastor Steve here, and welcome to another online service here at First AG Inverness. Thankful to be able to come to you via technology when we still can't meet in person yet, but hopefully and prayerfully that day is coming soon. Hopefully you've had a good week up until now and you're ready to worship. I've asked Heather Shaw, a member of our church, to come in and lead us in a couple of worship songs for tonight. So wherever you may be, if it's possible and you're able, why don't you stand with me and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Then we will worship for a couple of songs, and then we're going to dive into the Word this evening. So pray with me. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together in homes across our county and homes in other states. Lord, people who are tuned in tonight, Lord, I just pray that your presence would be felt here as much as it's felt in the homes, Lord, that you would just be everywhere this evening, that you would give us what we need, Father. I pray for your anointing over this service, anointing over this message, anointing over the worship, Father. Lord, I just pray over people, you know what their needs are and you know what they need. Anybody who's tuned in and watching this, Father, that you would meet their need, that you would give them what they need in this season. And Father, we just give you praise and glory and honor, and we worship you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Me.
Hey guys, welcome back from worship. Let's dive into the word this evening. If you would turn with me to Exodus chapter 15, that's where we're going to be spending the majority of our time in the word. And we're in our Names of God series, and this is part three. We've already done part one, which is Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Part two last week, which is Jehovah Nisi, the Lord, my banner in victory. And then part three today, we're going to get into is Jehovah-Rapha. Jehovah-Rapha. So why don't you turn with me to Exodus chapter 15. We're going to start reading in verse 22. So I'm going to give you just a moment to get there. You may be on a digital Bible or have your hard copy Bible out, but hopefully you're there by now. And we're going to start reading in verse 22. It reads like this. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. Then they went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. Now when they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah, which means bitter. And the people complained against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" So he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. And when he cast it into the waters were made sweet. There he made a statute and an ordinance for them, and there he tested them and said, "If you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you." Let's pray, and then we'll dive into the study. Father, we thank you for this time of worship together, for this time of study in your word. Father, I just pray that your blessing would be on the reading of this word tonight, that your anointing would be on the message itself. Father, help us to receive it, apply it to our lives, and believe your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So the Israelites, we find ourselves in this time, had come out of Egypt and they immediately faced a water problem. So Israel was pulled out of Egypt. Moses led them away from Egypt. Egypt begins to pursue them, and they find themselves pursued by the Egyptian army and facing a vast Red Sea. So they came out of Egypt and immediately faced a water problem. The problem was they could not cross the water. It was the Red Sea. God gave the Israelites pretty early on a water lesson. So as soon as he brings them out, he gave them a water lesson. So the whole first half of chapter 15, we just started in the second half of chapter 15, but the whole first half is a song of Moses and a song of Miriam giving God praise for delivering them through the Red Sea. So God, through Moses, led the Israelites. God, through Moses, led the Israelite people into the wilderness. So he led them into a wilderness time. How many of you know that God will take you into a wilderness in certain seasons of your life to teach you valuable lessons about who he is? Sometimes God will draw you into the wilderness. I'm always thinking of one of my favorite sources of scripture is in Hosea 2, when God leads Gomer out into the wilderness to show her a door of hope, or the door of Achor, or in the valley, I'm sorry, the valley of Achor, to give her a door of hope. So the valley of Achor was a valley of trouble, and in that valley of trouble, God gave her a door of hope. And in the same way that God did that for Gomer, which was Hosea's wife, God is doing it for the Israelite people right now. That although he's leading them out of Egypt and into a wilderness season, this wilderness season will serve as a door of hope for them moving forward into the future. So God will sometimes take you into a wilderness season in your life to teach you valuable lessons about who he is. How many of you know that the most valuable lessons that you typically learn about who God is happen when you're in the wilderness? They happen when you're in a season of trouble or a season of turmoil. When that happens, God will teach you a little bit about who he is. So now the Israelite people find themselves in a test. Have you ever been tested? Have you ever found yourselves in a test, right? We do it all the time. God tests us. God will teach us a lesson, then he'll test us on the lesson. Now, sometimes I pass, and sometimes I fail, and sometimes I've got to retake the test, and I'm sure the same is for you. Sometimes you pass the season of testing, and sometimes you fail, and you have to go back and retake the test. Well, the Israelite people are in a test right now. Now, if God had just delivered you from the Egyptians, and you just saw a miraculous splitting of the Red Sea so that you could walk right through it, like the song we've been singing lately, so you could walk right through it, would you trust him with a drinking water problem? So they had a water problem immediately coming out of Egypt with no way to cross the water. God made a way where there seems to be no way. And now they find themselves 3 days in the wilderness without finding drinkable water. In that moment, would you trust him with that problem? The truth is, the children of Israel are very much like us today. Why? Because they were people. We're people. The children of Israel like to argue and complain. We like to argue and complain, right? So they're people, we're people. Verse 24 said this that we read just a few moments ago. And the people complained against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" Right? So they immediately had seen God move miraculously in the Red Sea. And now just a short time later in the next chapter, they find themselves in the wilderness without drinking water. And they go to Moses and complain, saying, "What shall we drink?" So when facing a test, usually the first thing we do is what? We usually complain. Usually when we get into a testing season, we complain. The people complained to Moses, and what did Moses do? Moses complained to the Lord, right? So the people came to Moses and complained, did you lead us out into the wilderness just so that we could die? You know, did you allow God to do such a miracle in the Red Sea for us to cross over just so that we would die of thirst a few days later? You know, they immediately started to complain. So what did Moses do? Moses went to the Lord and complained, right? Moses typically went to the Lord and said, these people that you gave me, Lord, they're on my last nerve. And he basically went to the Lord and said, God, you see the situation, you see the problem, they're complaining to me, will you fix it? Will you do something about it? So Jehovah-Rapha, which is the name of God that we're talking about today, means I am the Lord who heals you. And it's right there in our text in verse 26. I am the Lord who heals you. Rapha is one who heals. That's R-O-P-H-E. Rapha is actually one who heals, and it's the Hebrew word for doctor. So it's the Hebrew word for physician is the one who heals. Rapha is the verb form, which is healing. So Rapha means healing. Something is actually happening, right? So Rapha being the base word for that, or the Hebrew word for doctor, it's very clear that what the Lord is talking about in this time is divine physical healing here. We still serve a God who heals. Amen. We still serve a God who heals so much that it's one of his names. It's one of his names that he's known for. He is Jehovah Rapha. I am the one who heals. He is the one who heals us, right? So it's so much so that it's actually a part of his name. So divine healing is actually a spiritual power made evident in a physical world. So divine healing means that there's something divine, there's something spiritual, there's something supernatural that's happening in our physical existence. So divine healing is God changing something in our physical world. So when God intervenes in our physical world, that's a supernatural event or divine event. The scriptures are talking about water, like God healing the drinking water for the Israelites, but that's still something that was in our physical world that God supernaturally intervened in spiritually to heal it, right? So divine healing is a spiritual intervention by God into the physical world, and that can happen with a sickness, that can happen with a disease, that can happen with the bitter waters that God healed and made sweet. My dad told me some stories recently. At the time I got to spend with him before he passed away, he shared a lot of history and things that had happened to him and things that God had done for him in his life. And there was one particular story that I remember that just came to my remembrance when I was preparing this message. And my dad and my mom and my aunts and uncles or their cousins were gathered together in a home, and they were praying. They were having a prayer meeting. And in that prayer meeting, they began to sense that God wanted to heal people in that prayer meeting. So they started calling on people who were sick and saying, if you're sick, let's stand up, get in the middle, let's lay hands on you and pray. So people were beginning to get up and come to the center of the circle, and they would lay hands on people, and people were falling out in the spirit. They were completely incapacitated in the spirit. The spirit was so strong in this room. My dad was telling the story to me, and he had tears just streaming down his face because he remembered how strong the presence of God was in this room that day, and that nobody could move for hours. Everybody in the room was just basking in the presence of God. Well, it was a couple of days later that my dad was driving his car, and something began to go wrong. He knew something was wrong with it, pulled into the driveway, and he and my mom's cousin got out and climbed underneath and looked, and it was leaking fuel. The fuel pump had actually ruptured, had cracked, and it was leaking fuel. And my dad and his cousin began to talk about what to do about this fuel pump, to go get a part. It was too late to get a part. It was a weekend, and this is back then when nothing was open on the weekends, and they were trying to decide what to do about it. And my dad remembered that healing service, and he said, God, if you can heal people, you can heal this fuel pump. So he laid hands on this fuel pump and began to pray, and they said you could see the fuel just pumping out of it. And as he prayed, it began to lessen and lessen and lesson. He took his hands off of it, looked at his cousin, and they looked at the fuel pump, and they saw that something was indeed beginning to change about it. Something was happening, and it was beginning to be repaired. So they laid hands on it again and began to pray and pray and pray. And when they got done praying, the fuel pump was repaired, and no fuel was leaking out. I think that's absolutely an incredible story, but these are the times that we need to understand that God's power is beyond what we can understand. So that if you're sick today, that you would have hope that if all you have to do is pray and reach out to God, and God can and does still heal people today. Amen. So we need to believe that. Genesis 20, verse 17 is the first mention of Rapha in the Bible. Abraham prays for Abimelech and his wife, and the Lord healed her infertility. So she and Abimelech were unable to have children. Abraham lays hands on them and prays and cries out to God for her healing, and the Lord heals her womb, and now her womb was opened, and she was able to have children. In Leviticus 13, verse 18, and chapter 14, verse 3, are a couple of references of God intervening supernaturally in healing leprosy and disease. So it's evident that God, as our healer, is an intervention from a supernatural God into a physical world. And mainly, it's there to heal our bodies. And He made a covenant with the people during that time. Scripture affirms that God is saying, I am Yahweh, your physician. That the first doctor and physician that we should ever look to is God the Father. The first physician is Him because it is one of His names. He is Yahweh, your physician. Amen. So God answers Moses, and He shows Moses a tree. Right? That seems kind of odd, doesn't it? There was a bitter water. It was some kind of contaminated water they couldn't drink. And God shows Moses a tree. And when Moses cast that tree into the waters were now made sweet and drinkable. How many of you read this story and you wonder, well, what kind of tree was that? How was the tree able to heal the waters? And what did the tree exactly do to the water to turn it clean? You know, and you think about things like that. But can I tell you today that it wasn't about the tree? It had nothing to do with the tree. The power wasn't in the tree. The power was in God, right? So the power was God's, not the tree's. It was about obedience and what God had asked him to do. God asked Moses to do something to bring healing to the waters. Moses was obedient and did it, and the waters were healed. So there in that moment, God made a statute and an ordinance for them, and there He tested them, is what the scripture says. So God put them before them a water test after they had just walked out of a water lesson, right? So they had walked through a water lesson with the Red Sea, and now they were in a test with water again. Some of them failed the test. Some may have passed the test. I think Moses probably passed the test because he was obedient to what the God asked him to do, and the water was healed. So these are the ordinance was this. First of all, if you diligently heed the voice of the Lord. Secondly, if you do what is right in His sight. And thirdly, listen to His commandments and keep His statutes. Then He will put none of the diseases on you that He put on the Egyptians. So this covenant or this ordinance is known as the Old Testament Divine Healing Covenant. God pairs His name with this covenant by calling Himself Yahweh Rapha. So I am the Lord your God who heals, right? Yahweh Rapha. That's the names like what we've been talking about with the other names. But can I tell you today that was the Old Testament covenant between God for healing, but we have a New Testament covenant. So what's the difference between the Mosaic covenants or the covenants that God made with Moses and the people in the Old Testament and the covenants God makes with us today? The covenants that God is in with us today is through His Son, Jesus Christ. Right? So it's no longer an if-then covenant like the covenants of the Old Testament, or if-then covenant like the divine healing of the Old Testament, but now it's solely based on who Jesus is, not how good we are. Now, although we still strive to keep his commandments and do what is right in the sight of God, when we fail doesn't mean that that suddenly sicknesses and things will overtake us, right? So we know that the source of sicknesses and diseases in this world is because it's a fallen world. It's because of the original sin with Adam and Eve. It started in the garden, right? So there's an original sin in a fallen world, and we know that that's the cause of it, but the cure is Jesus Christ. Right? The cure is being in covenant with him. And Jesus Christ is known as our sin bearer because he bared the sins of the world. James chapter 5 verses 14 through 16 reads like this: Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. So what is the ordinance now? The ordinance now is that we are in covenant with Jesus Christ, who is our sin bearer. He bared the sins of the world. So he's regularly pursuing renewed consecration through him. What in the world does that mean? That means that daily we need to ask Jesus for forgiveness of our sins. That every time we fall short, every time we miss the mark, we need to renew our covenant with Christ. Come to him and ask him for forgiveness so that he covers us afresh and anew in his blood, so that we are forgiven people, so that what we ask of God shall be done, because the prayers of a righteous man availeth much. And although we cannot be righteous apart from Christ, so it's in our relationship with Christ that we are righteous, and it's in our relationship with Christ that our prayers availeth much. So summing up what we've covered so far in this series is this. We talked about Jehovah Jireh, that the Lord is your provider. We talked about Jehovah Nissi, the Lord your banner in victory. And then we talked about today Jehovah Rapha, which is the Lord your physician. Have you noticed a couple of things remain the same through all those names? One, the Lord, and the second one is your, right? So if he is your Lord, then he is your provider. If he is your Lord, then he is your banner. And if he is your Lord, then he is your physician. Amen. So we've got to call to God whenever we have need, whenever we're facing battle and we need him as a banner, and whenever we're facing illness, sickness, and we need him to heal something in our lives. I think about just the moment in time that the water was bitter. You know, and we're talking about physical healing in the body, but part of physical healing is also emotional and mental healing as well. So you may need a physical healing today, or you may need an emotional or spiritual or mental healing today. But I find it interesting that the reason the water was contaminated is because it was bitter, and they could not drink of it. I wonder how many today watching this video are dealing with situations in your life that has just made you bitter. It's made you bitter, and you need the Lord's healing to get your waters that are flowing within you to not be bitter, but to be life-giving. Right? So I want to offer a specific prayer to those of you who may be dealing with bitterness or dealing with issues of emotional turmoil or issues of mental stress and anguish, and you just may have some bitterness in you that needs to be healed. The first prayer I want to offer is for that. And then we're going to flow into prayer for healing for your body. So if you need a healing in your body today, would you just right where you are, just raise your hand and say, Lord, Lord, I need a mighty touch in my body today. You might be by yourself in your room, and that's okay. You might be by yourself physically, but you're not by yourself spiritually. We're with you together, and we're going to pray together in unity. So if you're home today and you don't need a healing emotionally, spiritually, mentally, or physically, why don't you just pray with me for those that do, those who are watching that need a mighty touch in their body, that need that bitterness to be exuded, need sweet, sweet water to once again flow through them, and those who need a physical touch in their body as well. So why don't you just pray with me, church, and some of you come in agreement with me, and those of you who need prayer, just lift your hands and open yourself up to the Lord right now and receive this prayer of healing. Let's pray. Father, we just give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory. Lord, you are Jehovah-Rapha. You are the ultimate physician. Father, I just declare your healing power right now wherever there's people that are sick that are joining in and watching. Where there's people who need a mighty touch in their body today, Father, I pray that you would move and do the miraculous and give them the touch that they need. Where those who are ill in spirit, Lord, those who are dealing and struggling with emotional turmoil or mental turmoil or have bitterness in their life, Father, I just declare that you would heal them miraculously right now. Father, that you would move on them, that they would let go of the things they've held on to that they need to turn over to you. That they would release the things that they've clung on to, Lord, that they need to give to you today. Father, I declare today that those bitter waters would be made whole and well in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, that you would turn the waters from bitter and unable to be used to a sweet, sweet, life-giving and life-changing water. Father, declare your healing power through every body that's watching today. Anyone who has issues in muscle or bone or blood or cancer, we speak against it and we command it to yield to the mighty name of Jesus Christ today. Father, you said that we can come together in unity and we can ask for any good thing and it shall be given to us today, Father. And we come together as a church family and we unite in one prayer, believing for the healing in the bodies of those who are watching this service. Father, that you would do a miracle amongst us, Lord. Let us hear reports of miracles from this prayer and from this time of gathering together. And Lord, we give you all praise. We give you all glory. We give you all thanks. And we worship you for what you're done, what you're about to do, what you're going to do, Lord. We give you praise and honor in Jesus' name. And every one of you said, amen. Church, God bless you. Thank you so much for joining with us today. We just thank you for continuing to be faithful in this season to the church, faithful to this body of believers, and connecting with us online. We thank you for that. So join us Sunday morning as we continue our Testify series. God bless.